My name is Sandeep Patel. I'm from Duke University Medical Center in Durham, North Carolina, United States of America. And today I'll be talking about testicular cancer. The learning objectives of this talk include recognizing the epidemiology, risk factors, and clinical presentation of testicular cancer, understanding the diagnosis, evaluation, and treatment of testicular malignancies, and identifying the long-term follow-up and survivorship issues related to testicular cancer. The outline of this presentation, I'll begin by discussing the epidemiology and the risk factors for testicular cancer, followed by the clinical presentation, diagnostic evaluation, prognosis, management and treatment of these patients, and finally long-term survivorship issues. The epidemiology of testicular cancer. In the United States, this is the most common solid tumor in males aged 15 to 35. It's more common in Caucasians and less common in Asia and Africa. In the United States, there are 8,300 new cases yearly, with about 380 deaths yearly. This is due to significant advances in therapy related to testicular cancer, particularly cisplatin-based chemotherapy, and the development of high-dose chemotherapy with autologous stem cell rescue, which have both substantially improved long-term outcomes in these patients. The major risk factors for testicular cancer include cryptorchidism and hypospadias, both of which represent genitourinary developmental abnormalities. In particular, cryptorchidism can result in the development of testicular cancer either in the undescended testicle or the contralateral descended testicle. The development of an extragonadal germ cell tumor, an alternative site, for example, in the mediastinum or pineal area, can also portend an elevated risk of the development of testicular cancer. HIV has become an increasingly recognized risk factor for testicular cancer, and to a lesser extent, family history. The clinical presentation of testicular cancer is varied. In general, most patients will notice a painless swelling or mass in the testicle, as well as a dull ache or fullness in the scrotum. More atypically, after puberty, the development of gynecomastia and impotence can also portend the development of testicular cancer. The differential diagnosis of these lesions is broad and include testicular torsion, which is a medical emergency, epididymitis, and hydrocele. In a patient with testicular erythema concerning for epididymitis that does not resolve after a course of antibiotics, further evaluation for testicular malignancy is mandatory. The evaluation of these patients includes physical examination, scrotal ultrasound, and serologic evaluation, assessing for serum levels of alpha-fetoprotein, beta-human chorionic gonadotropin, or beta-HCG, and lactate dehydrogenase, or LDH. In addition, prior to surgical or chemotherapeutic intervention, discussions regarding fertility preservation and cryopreservation of sperm should be discussed with the patient. In addition, baseline CT chest, abdomen, pelvis for staging will help assess the degree of patient's disease and allow it to better assess the patient's prognosis and treatment options. In terms of PET scanning, due to the high false negative rate in testicular cancer, PET scanning is not routinely used at the time of diagnosis. Of note, from a serological perspective, any elevation in alpha-fetoprotein indicates a non-seminoma pathology, and tumor markers should normalize after surgical treatment, in the case of alpha-fetoprotein approximately 3 weeks, and in the case of beta-HCG within 1 week, with lack of normalization requiring further diagnostic evaluation. In terms of prognosis, testicular cancer has the best prognosis among solid tumors. The 5-year survival rate is approximately 95%, and the long-term cure rate is 80%. In terms of staging for these patients, both pathologic evaluation as well as radiographic evaluation for staging are important. Seminoma has a better prognosis relative to non-seminoma pathology. Non-seminomas are characterized by 4 distinct pathologic types, often with overlap, including embryonal carcinoma, teratoma, choriocarcinoma, and yolk sac tumor. Oftentimes, non-seminomas and seminomas can be present within the same pathologic specimen, and the patient's prognosis is determined by the most aggressive pathology present. Any elevation of alpha-fetoprotein indicates a non-seminoma pathology. From a prognostic standpoint, metastatic spread to the lung is important in staging, as well as the absolute degree of elevation of tumor markers, including alpha-fetoprotein, beta-HCG, and LDH. Management of patients with testicular cancer requires a multidisciplinary team. Surgery is the mainstay of diagnosis and treatment. Biopsy is not advised, as rupture of the scrotal sac can result in tumor seeding into the peritoneum. Thus, radical inguinal orchiectomy is advised for patients suspected of having testicular cancer. Retroperitoneal lymph node dissection may be required in some patients. Radiation, particularly in seminoma pathologies which are more sensitive to radiation, can be helpful in reducing relapse risk. The chemotherapeutic management of these patients is important as well, and has represented a significant advance in terms of improving mortality in these patients. Chemotherapy is the backbone of metastatic disease, and the development of cisplatin-based chemotherapy has revolutionized the management of testicular cancer. Of note, chemotherapy regimens often include bleomycin, which is a chemotherapy agent that can lead to long-term pulmonary toxicity, especially in patients receiving supplemental oxygen during chemotherapy administration. Chemotherapy is potentially curative upfront, but for those patients who relapse despite second-line therapy, high-dose chemotherapy with autologous stem cell transplantation is a potentially curative option. As the prognosis of these patients has improved, long-term follow-up is of great importance. Routine history and physical examination is important, with serial measurement of serum tumor markers to detect early relapse, which can oftentimes be managed with local therapies such as surgery or radiation. Scheduled imaging with CT is also indicated, especially in the setting of rising tumor markers or new symptoms. Survivorship issues have become increasingly important as the prognosis of this disease has improved. Long-term toxicity of this therapy are important as patients are becoming long-term survivors of testicular cancer. As mentioned earlier, bleomycin can lead to long-term lung damage. Cisplatin can result in kidney damage as well as neuropathy and hearing loss. Both etoposide and radiation can lead to secondary cancers, including leukemia. Hypogonadism is an inherent problem in many patients with testicular cancer that is exacerbated by removal of the testicle, as well as administration of chemotherapy and radiation. In addition, chemotherapy can have long-term adverse effects on patients' lipid profiles and blood pressure. In summary, testicular cancer is a rare but potentially curable tumor of men in their 20s and 30s. Evaluation of tumor markers such as alpha-fetoprotein, beta-HCG, and lactate dehydrogenase are important in diagnosis and to assess for treatment response and relapse. Biopsy is not advised as tumor seeding can occur, and radical orchiectomy is the standard of care for diagnosis and treatment. Fertility preservation and assessment of long-term toxicities are important as outcomes for these patients improve with advances in therapy, and continued observation with serial tumor markers and symptom-guided imaging are important in detecting early relapse, which can respond to local therapies. Thank you for your attention.